afternoon, everyone. Thank you all for coming. My name is Heather Pozieritzky. I wish it was as easy as Gillis, but it's not. And I am Roger's great niece, and it's my honor and privilege to be here with you guys today. We're just going to open with a quick prayer, if you bow your heads with me. Father God, we thank you, Lord, that you've given us this day and this time to remember Roger. We thank you, Lord, for the legacy that he's left behind. Father, we thank you, God, that his death was not the end, but Lord, it's the beginning. Of his time with you in heaven, Father. He will be missed. But God, we thank you that he's up there with you. We thank you that he's with his wife, his mother, his sister, and everyone else who's gone before him. God, we're so thankful to be here together today to remember him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Should have asked for large print. Roger was born September 10th, 1947 in Mount Pleasant, Iowa, the son of Sanford Earl and Pansy Mae Gillis. He graduated from Pekin High School and was united in marriage to Sharon K. Schultz August 19th, 1967 at the Ainsworth Community Church. In his early years of employment, he worked the wheat harvest traveling from Canada to Texas. He was also employed with L.L. Pelling in North Liberty, Rath Packing in Columbus Junction, Central Soya Master Mix Feeds in Washington. He owned and operated Gillis Transport and retired after 25-plus years with Heartland Express, celebrating 3 million consecutive miles accident-free. He was a member of the Ainsworth Fire Department and the Ainsworth First Responders. He was a longtime volunteer with the Ainsworth Opera House and the Washington County Fair. Survivors include his children, Lori and Mark of Ainsworth, Roger and Elizabeth of Needville, Texas, grandchildren Lindsay, Cedric, Eli, Trina, Seth, Sierra, and Wyatt, and great-grandchildren Lydia, Emma, and Noah, and his special friend Alice Foster. He was preceded in death by his parents, his wife Sharon, brother Ivan Gillis, and sister Mary Ann McReynolds. Roger's kids have requested that we play a song that was one of Roger's favorites, and I guess I hear from the story behind it is that Lori got her first record player and a Beach Boys album, and this was the song that he always wanted her to play over and over again.
Round, round, get around, I get around, yeah, get around, round, round, I get around,
I get around.
Get around.
sure that brought back a lot of good memories, not just of Roger, but for everyone who was in the Beach Boys era. I saw some people tapping their foot. Right now, we would like to take time just to share memories, and we're going to start with Roger's daughter, Lori, and then we've got another special person that wants to share something, and then we'll open it up to whoever would like to share. We would ask that you would come up here to use the microphone so that it can be recorded well. So we'll start. I'll hand it to you. We'll start with Lori. Hold on just a second.
Clearly not going to stand behind the podium. So we all know that he was didn't give a lot of advice. And the day of our wedding, we were taking pictures all day long. He didn't really say too much. He'd smile and talk to us a little bit, but not really a lot. And then when it come time for us to go hide while everybody was coming, arriving, everything, I was downstairs at the church with my bridesmaids, and my dad shows up. He shows up, and he's just hanging out with us girls, still really not saying too much. And so we're just keep on talking or whatever, and it came time for us to go upstairs. And so he's still walking behind me, not really saying too much. So we're get up there, and we're standing side by side. And he takes hold of my arm, and I was expecting him to say something, you know, it's my dad. I'm waiting for him to say something memorable, whatever. Well, it was memorable, all right. He grabs a hold of my arm, we're standing there, he looks at me, and he goes, I'm only planning on doing this one time. I said, good, because I'm only planning on doing this one time. There were a couple other times when some family things were happening, and it was my mom and me and Mark and Dad, and there were things going on, and my mom was ranting and raving nonstop about what we were doing. She was pitching stuff. She was going on and on, and of course my dad still was not saying anything, not one thing. We kept on doing what we needed to do. We were moving stuff, this and that, and at the very last minute, when we were walking out the door, Mom and Mark were already outside. Like I said, we'd been there an hour. He had not said one word. We got ready to leave, and I was walking out the door, and all of a sudden I heard him go, I'm gonna tell you something, and I can't, to the certain person. He said, I'm gonna tell you something. Oh, I gotta hear this, because I knew. And he goes, and he said what he had to say. I'm like, yeah, I can't repeat what he said, but I'm like, that's just it. He never really gave you any advice, but when he had something to say, you better listen, because that was it. And that's what it was like. And then when I was making the picture boards, I did all the family ones first, because that's what he was, you know? He was family, that's the way we were. But he also had a silly side, because if you look at the next board, there are all the other things he would do. And the other thing that he did, hummed all the time, was from Sesame Street. He would go, manamana, out of nowhere. Manamana, manamana, and I'm like, we'd be driving down the road, and all of a sudden, you just hear him. That's what he would say. So those are some of the things. I'm going to tell you one other one that's funny, because, and I just told it a little bit ago. When he would decide to go hang out with us younger kids, and they would go down to the bar with us, Robin would call me and say, is Uncle Roger going to the bar tonight? And I'm like, yes. And Robin would go, okay, I got to take 2 packs of cigarettes. Because my dad would inevitably always ask Robin for a cigarette. And by the end of the night, my dad would end up smoking one whole pack of cigarettes. Poor Robin. And I'm just like, just stuff like that. That's what Dad would do. I mean, he would hang out with us, and it would be okay. And then he would be stern when he had to, and that's the way it was. And so I hope you guys have memories like that the way that we do. I know you guys do, and how ornery he was. And so, so.
So the next memories that we have, I received a piece of paper because he doesn't know that he's going to be able to make through it. And I told him, I got your back, man. If you can't do it, I'll read it for you. But I don't guarantee that I will get through it. So have patience with me. I'm a big crier and a firm believer that nobody cries alone when they're with me. So this says, Dear Grandpa, I hope you have a good life in heaven. I will remember all of my good times and bad times and the memories that we all had together and all the times that you spoiled me with toys and clothes. I wish you the best life with Grandma, and I will never forget you. You're the best grandpa I ever knew, and I knew that you loved me. Sincerely, Wyatt. There's anybody else that would like to share a memory, you're welcome to come up. Just stand right up and come forward. Sure.
Well, I think I've known Roger longer than anybody else here. It was probably 2 or 3 months before kindergarten when I first met him. So that's quite a long time ago, actually 70-some years ago. But anyhow, we had a great time growing up, and we did some pretty ornery things at times. And of course, you know Roger, that's the way he is. We hung out all through school, kind of got separated after school when I went into the service, and afterwards he was my best man at my wedding. So actually we did hang around quite a bit during our lifetimes, and I'd call him or he'd call me. I can't remember how many times, but 4 or 5 times a year we'd talk to each other, probably took an hour, hour and a half at each time, and got through all that. And this was a real excuse me. It just seemed like we were going to be together forever. I'd be able to call him or he call me, and of course it didn't work out that way. Our birthdays were 10 days apart, actually. So that was another thing that kind of drew us together when we were young all the time. But anyhow, I'm going to quit talking and let somebody else talk.
Thank you, Paul. You're welcome.
Is there anybody else that has anything they'd like to share? Okay, then JR has a song that he would like to share. You just want me to play it? Got it.
Yeah. I'm Kim Kirshner. Sharon and Roger. Took me in as their own because of Lori. And Lori and I met in high school, junior high, and we didn't always see eye to eye back then and had our indifferences throughout those years. But after high school, we've been pretty much inseparable. And that included coming here and working with Sharon and Roger to do meals and celebrate with the Gillis and mainly Schultz families, and I just want you all to know I am very honored, privileged to have been a part of all of your lives. So, not ready for this next step, so unfortunately it's already here, but that's all I can say.
They loved you just as much as they loved us.
Tell your old man you'll do some largemouth fish in another town. You just got too much on your plate to bait and cast a line. You can always put a rain check in his hand till you can't. You can keep putting off forever with that girl whose heart you hold, swearing that you'll last someday further down the road. You can always put a diamond on her hand till you can. If you got a chance, take it. Take it while you got a chance. If you got a dream, chase it, 'cause the dream won't chase you back. If you're gonna somebody, hold them as long and as strong and as close as you can, till you can. There's a box of greasy parts sitting in the trunk of that 65, still waiting on you and your granddad to bring it back to life. You can always get around to fixing up that Pontiac till you can. Just talk away, 'cause you'll never know how bad you wanna till you can't someday. Don't wait on tomorrow, 'cause tomorrow may not show. Say your sorries, your I love yous, 'cause man, you never know. If you got a chance, take it. Take it while you got a chance. If you got a dream, chase it, 'cause the dream won't chase you back. If you're gonna love somebody, hold them as long and as strong and as close as you can, till you can. Yeah, if you got a chance, take it. Take it while you got a chance. If you got a dream, chase it, 'cause the dream won't chase you back. If you're gonna love somebody, hold them as long and as strong and as close as you can.
I think that's a really good message, that you have a chance until you don't. And I just want to, before we pray, just share one of my memories of Roger. And I just remember, I didn't get to spend a lot of time with him. I wasn't always in the area. I wasn't always in the country. But all of my memories of Roger were that you could always tell that he loved you, no matter what. And it didn't matter if you made choices that he thought that you should make or shouldn't make. It didn't matter if you made the wrong choice and you went down the wrong road. It didn't matter, because to him, you were family and he loved you. And I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, with every fiber of my being, that he is in heaven. And, you know, I know that he had a lot of physical issues, but, you know, when you get to heaven, all of that goes away. And there's no more pain and no more sorrow. And I bet you anything, he's got Sharon's hand running down those streets of gold because he can run again. And I know that he made a decision before he died that he believed in Jesus with all of his heart. And I know that if he were here today, right now, he would ask you, have you made that decision? Do you know Jesus? Do you believe in Jesus? Because in the Bible it says, believe in Jesus and you'll be saved. And I know that there's some of us in here who have heard this since we were little toddlers. And sometimes we let it soak in and sometimes we don't let it soak in. But we have a chance, and we need to take that chance before we can't take that chance anymore. And if we want to be there and see the face of Jesus as we pass from this world into the next, and then see the faces of our loved ones who've gone there before us, then we have to take that chance, and we have to make the decision that we're going to believe and we're going to live for Christ, because he died for us, and Roger believed that in the last days. He believed it with all of his heart, and I know because I was there. And I know that if he was here right now, he would say to every single person in here, man, it's worth it. It's worth it. Don't think that this religious stuff is just dumb. It's worth it. Amen. It's worth the choice. It's worth the decision. It's worth the change in your life. And if you don't know Jesus today, I'm not going to make you come up front. I'm not going to have an altar call. But I'm going to pray a prayer as we start to wrap things up. And you can say it in your head, you can say it out loud, you can do it however you want to do, but if you don't know Jesus and you want to know Jesus, Roger would say to you, it's worth it. It's worth it. Take the chance while you can still take the chance, because we don't know what tomorrow brings. We don't know what we're going to be doing. We don't know if we're still going to be breathing when we wake up tomorrow. It's time to take the chance while we can still take the chance. Bow your heads with me. Father God, I just pray for every single soul in this room. Lord, I pray for those who believe in you and those who don't believe in you. Father God, I pray that you would reveal yourself in a mighty way in this place today. We thank you, God, that Roger is up there and he is in your arms and he is whole and he is free. Father, we thank you, God, that his body is whole and that you've wiped away his tears and you've taken away his pain. God, we want to be there too. Father, we want to be in your arms. The Bible says that if we're absent from the body, then we're present from the Lord. Jesus, when we take our last breath, we want to open our eyes and see your face. Father God, I just pray. Jesus, forgive me of my sins. I believe in you, and I want to change my life and live for you. Help me, God, to accept your forgiveness and your unconditional love. Lord, Roger loved with an unconditional love, and we know how much more your love is for us, that no matter how far we've strayed, no matter how many steps we've taken away, that your glory and your presence is only one step back. All we have to do is turn around and see that you're right there behind us. We thank you, God, that you love us no matter what you've done. Father, we thank you for the life and the legacy of Roger. We thank you, God, that his love will live on through his children and his grandchildren and his great-grandchildren and in this community. Father, I just pray that you would reach out and touch every heart here, and you would give us peace and strength through these hard times, God. Lord, we thank you for everything. In Jesus' name, amen.
So I'm Roger Gillis, Jr. I'm sure everybody in here knows me as JR, mostly. So when we were little, we had an 8-track player in our house. And I have a song that I'm going to play, and you're more than welcome to get up and talk to people and mingle. If you'd like to sit and listen to it, you can do that. But we went through 3 of these 8-tracks. And I learned a lot of things from this 8-track tape, and these songs are on there, that Dad never hesitated to take the time. Dad, what's Wolf Creek Pass? Dad, what's the Silverton? Dad, what's the Aurora Borealis? All these things. Never hesitated. Like I said, we went through 3 of these tapes, and I thought it would only be appropriate to close the ceremony with this song. That's not it. And I screwed it up.
Yeah, Breaker 19, this here's a rubber duck. You've got a copy on me, Big Ben, come on. Yeah, 10-4, Big Ben, for sure, for sure. By golly, it's clean, clear to Flagtown, come on. Yeah, it's a Big 10-4 there, Big Ben. Yeah, we definitely got the front door, good buddy. Mercy sakes alive, looks like we've got us a convoy.
Was a dark of the moon on the 6th of June in a Kenworth pulling logs. Cab over Pete with a reefer on and a Jimmy hauling hogs. We is heading for Bear on I-10 about a mile out of Shaky Town. I says, Pigpen, this here's a rubber duck and I'm about to put the hammer down.
Cause we got a little convoy rocking through the night. Yeah, we got a little convoy, it's your beautiful sight. Come on, join our convoy.
Back off them hogs. Do a 10-4, about 5 miles or so. 10, roger, them hogs is getting intense up here.
By the time we got into Tulsa Town, we had 85 trucks in all. But there's a roadblock up on the Cloverleaf, and them bears is wall to wall. Yeah, them smokies as thick as bugs on a bumper. They even had a bear in the air. I says, calling all trucks, this here's the duck. We about to go a hunting a bear.
Cause we got a great big convoy rocking through the night. Yeah, we got a great big convoy. Ain't she a beautiful sight? Come on and join our convoy. Ain't never gonna get in our way.
You want to give me a 10-9 on that, Big Ben? Negatory, Big Ben. You're still too close. Yeah, them hogs are starting to close up my sinuses. Mercy sake, you better back off another 10.
Well, we rolled up Interstate 44 like a rocket sled on rails. We tore up all of our swindle sheets and left them setting on the scales. By the time we hit that shy town, them bears was getting smart. They brought up some reinforcements from the Illinois National Guard. There's armored cars, tanks, jeeps, and rigs of every size. Yeah, them chicken coops was full of bears, and choppers filled the skies. Well, we shot the line, we went for broke, with 1,000 screaming trucks, and 11 long-haired friends of Jesus in a chartreuse microbus.
Yeah, rubber duck just sodbuster. Come on here, yeah. 10-4 sodbuster. Listen, you want to put that microbus in behind that suicide jockey? Yeah, he's all dynamite. He needs all the help he can get.
Well, we laid a strip for the Jersey Shore and prepared to cross the line. I could see the bridge was lined with bears, but it didn't have a doggone dime. I says, Pigpen, this here's a rubber duck. We just ain't going to pay no toll. So we crashed the gate doing 98. I says, let them truckers roll 10-4.
Cause we got a mighty convoy rocking through the night. Yeah, we got a mighty convoy. Ain't she a beautiful sight?
Just want to thank everybody for being here, and that's all we have today. And there'll be refreshments, I guess. I just found this out. So.